My name is Paul Leenhaus, that's the Dutch way of saying it. I've been a musician for a long time. I think I started playing around the age of 7. My father actually was an organist. He actually wanted to become an organist, but that was not allowed by his parents because it was not regarded as a job, you know, in the, let's say, the 20s, 30s in Holland, where I'm originally from. But for sure, he put his passion and his love for music in his children. My sister plays the violin, and she plays in Concertgebouw Orchestra. My niece, who was here actually last year, also picked up the violin, so actually we're from quite a musical nest. Although actually at a certain age, it was actually not my idea to become a musician, but rather a sailor man. And that's also what I did as a teenager. I worked on a hospital ship for the Dutch fishing fleet for 4 years, which I enjoyed tremendously. If I had the opportunity to see the Hebrides, for example, Ireland, all the islands between northern Scotland and Iceland. A time which I'll never forget. It's nice to be in between the elements. And in a particular way, the life of a sailorman and a musician is quite similar. You share a small space, you have to get along, but maybe what sailormen realize even better, that if you were between the elements, you can pretend whatever you want, but actually you're almost nothing. And that can be sometimes a little bit different in the arts world, of course, with good reason or less good reasons. In Leiden, I was at the music school, very active, played in many ensembles. And it was actually a clarinet teacher who talked to me and said, "Have you ever thought of going to the Conservatory of Music?" Which I never did. But actually, I'm thankful to this teacher, clarinet teacher, because it made me think, and I applied to the Conservatory in Amsterdam, and I absolutely loved it from day one. I just went for recorder and oboe. I also picked up the oboe when I was 12. You know, in some circles, the recorder was still seen like, okay, that's a great instrument for beginners. But I always stay hooked to it. Maybe not so much as a teenager, because I was rather ashamed to tell people that I was playing recorder. The funny thing about recorder is that it doesn't have any status. And that's a fascinating thing, because yes, you're a bit concerned about telling people that you play such a weird instrument as a teenager, and then after maybe 10 years you think, yeah, but if you tell people that you play saxophone and everybody goes, oh yeah, that doesn't say anything either, you know? So. In a way, I actually gave up playing the oboe after 3 years. I studied it a lot, even at the Conservatory of Amsterdam, but it actually finally didn't appeal to me. Still like the instrument, but I rather prefer to be active with it than to listen to it. I don't know what it is. And maybe because this strange educational pencil called the recorder, you know, with no status, is far more difficult to play well than anything else. But there is absolutely no schmuck on it. It's super simple. It doesn't guarantee you a place in any ensemble or orchestra. But still, I think it's a great instrument to. I think you have to be rather smart to play it, but you also have to put your soul into it. Otherwise, it will absolutely, it doesn't work. So as a performer, I've been touring actually for a very long time. I think probably more than 30 years. I was a member of a quartet, and for 24 years, same people. Perhaps we were also a bit lucky because there were no other groups who actually got together. So we were more or less the first ones. I think there was a quartet in Tokyo or something who were together for a couple of years. But I think, and it was definitely, of course, not a goal to create a name or something, but it just happened. And I think we started in 1978 as a bit of like naughty students. And we would play anything possible, you know, varying from like canzones from the 17th century to, we also arranged like commercial tunes, like, or you know, like a commercial for a Dutch beer or something. And then after being together for a couple of months, we suddenly got our first concert and we had to come up with a name. And the thing I remember that we didn't want to have anything with Antiqua or Musica in the name. Anything interesting will actually get my attention or will steal my heart or not, that can be. But for sure, I found it exciting. And while thinking of it, it's maybe because I write myself too. I've been a composer also for 20 years, but I also admire composers. It's always a fascinating process. You know, you get something in your head, and it can be super small, and it can turn into a symphony or a whatever, a great event. But just the whole process where you go through and also not just the difficulties, but you have to be patient. You're getting very uncertain about the things you create because you don't know. And even when you're finished, you think, you go through moments that you think, I'm going to throw the whole thing away because it's nothing. And then very often it takes like 4 or 5 days, you think, maybe it's not so bad. Or when you feel from other people that they actually like it or they found something inspiring, and then you feel great, of course. But I think I always respected people who create something also by hand, not only musicians, but also like carpenters or people who create something. And you need guts to do it. As a composer, I like also slightly unusual instrumentation sometimes, but not again, not just to, you know, think, oh, this is gonna be cool if I put this with that instrument next to that, because I was just fascinated by it. But for example, I wrote a piece for soprano educational pencil with accordion. I love accordion. Mm-hmm. My goodness. You know, it was also like, thought like, oh yeah, sure, you played in bars or Sailor Man or, in Germany, they have a fantastic name for accordion. They call it Alpenkompressor. It's really bad, of course, you know. Thank you. Sometimes, like, you get the tendency, or what it feels like in the last 10 years, that everything is about marketing your own art. And of course, we all need to survive, but it's not the way you start, you know? And the same is valid for pop musicians, where you think, my goodness, well, it feels like people are selected because of their hair color or their faces, then you would start with your bro and some friends from the hood, and you would just, you know, bang on some instruments every weekend, and then you become a pop group or something, you know. So I absolutely adore people who create something, either with their minds or with their hands. And honestly, although of course these people are not alive, but I have the same sensation when I am confronted with music from the past, and it can be the very far past. It can be medieval music. I love, for example, the so-called Ars Subtilior. So we're talking about the beginning of the 14th century, the music of the troubadour. And they were not only great musicians, but their poetry was of the highest level. It was definitely music and poetry for the elite. I'm absolutely not afraid of it. It's like we also, like, it became sort of fashionable to think like, okay, any art should be accessible. You know, you get this sort of cartoon-like explanation of compositions, of paintings, and interactive. Honestly, I don't believe in it. I think it's very important to listen, and also to be, you know, to get curious, for me that's a magic word. And I also hope that all the people I work with, it doesn't matter, colleagues, musicians, artists, students, that people are curious and they don't say, you know, it all sounds the same to me, because then you make a big mistake as an artist. Because Even when you look at a brick wall, even in this space, a lot of bricks here. It depends how you look. If you look very closely, not even one brick is the same, you know. So some people tend to say that, yeah, like Mozart it's all the same, or Renaissance music, it's all the same. Then you kill yourself as a curious human being or as an artist. And of course, it's logical that you don't like everything, so that's more than fine. But to make a statement that everything is the same, then you do too short to yourself, to my opinion. I love to inspire curiosity by all means, and in that sense, I'm a bit in the third phase of my life. You know, like of course, when you're young, everybody's exploring. And then had a sort of a touring life. Also taught in Amsterdam for 18 years. And now it's great to, it's also an honor to be in charge of a program like this. And it also, I mean, I still love playing, absolutely, by all means. But at this point in my life, I wouldn't be so interested in just teaching one instrument or just my instrument. I love being in touch with many different instrumentalists. I also learn from it. I feel with the experience of you know, being a musician of like for 30, 40 years, I've collected a lot of music. I like to put a lot of pieces into my computer to create musical exhibitions. That's how I want to call it. And so I'm not so fond of tutti frutti. So I'm a bit afraid of putting a Vermeer painting next to an Andy Warhol. Although I don't exclude it, because when they share the same theme, I think it would be a great idea to do it. As an artist, you also have to, of course, you have to respect your audience, but you also have to educate your audience, or try to drag the ear or the eye or any other sense to something which people probably never seen or heard before. It's interesting that in general, the taste of an audience rather goes with people or with pieces or productions they have heard before. And of course, there has a lot to do with marketing, but marketing has always been around. And I'm convinced that Handel was also a very commercial person in a very commercial theater and music world, like in London at the time. And it doesn't mean that the quality suffered of it, but still you hear the influence. And honestly, I also think that it's the case with many of the famous composers. If you, for example, look at all printed editions, I always say around 1860 or something, which are full of hairpins and crescendi and diminuendo, and you know, almost every single staccato is printed, you know, commas too, and that never happened before. And I think, wow, that's interesting, you know. And so is that because the composers are more demanding, or is it because the musicians don't have fantasy anymore? That's really the question, you know. We lost the experiment. Without experiment, we don't learn. Unfortunately, many people find this a waste of time. I don't think so. You know, if you don't try out things, you're not streetwise. You know, and including things like, no, I'm not going to do this again. That's fine. I'm strongly convinced that actually most schools, music schools in the world, are still based on the Paris Conservatory model. I'm not just critical about it. I think there are many good things about it, you know, including a knowledge of solfège and theory, and more or less like, okay, you have your teacher is the best player in an orchestra, and if you polish your tone and you do everything, your teacher says you eventually will take over the place in an orchestra. But there's so much more than that, of course. And so, in a way, just hear it also in the tone production with many classical musicians, which I don't in jazz. You know, like you can recognize a great jazz artist by just listening to the fluff before even the first note has started. And, another thing I really admire in genuine musicians, you know, when they just use their ears. Fantastic ears. And sometimes we think, oh no, we should practice more and more. And sometimes we forget that we should improve our ear implant instead of other things, which we have been working on already maybe too long. Yeah? And I'm not saying it's nonsense, but this more than just to practice in a certain way. And sometimes we should also vary, I think. No. And the other thing is, yes, which I found very fascinating. You know, like comparing composers, players from the past with musicians who live now. What strikes my mind is, I think that almost any composer was a fantastic performer, and not only on one instrument, but very often up to five. And the best players were also great composers. Nowadays, be careful. I think the best. I don't ask the best players to either to improvise or to compose something, or ask the best composer to perform their own works. Of course, there are exceptions. But it has become a bit of a tricky business. And I think, why? We can play Bach on a Hohner electronic organ, and we can play it on an accordion, and it will still sound like Bach, you know. But I think you should be curious again, and once you get the opportunity to just to observe, to touch, and to play even an instrument, you know, which was actually in use at the time, that might change your ideas a little bit. More than the thought that you have to play authentic, because in fact I think authentic, you're only authentic if you are authentic to yourself. Do that with great taste and also with knowledge. It's easy to adapt something fashionable, but I don't believe in it, you know. But you should be interested in the interesting and also artful information which is given to us also through books or through music. But please, please, again, participate. But one thing we cannot escape is, for example, if you just have the opportunity to play a Mozart piano sonata on an instrument where he played on, or you played on a modern Steinway, and it can be equally well done, but the sound will be, and the touch will be completely different. Why? Because also, like, people were longing for something different at the time. I think internet has a huge influence on us. Partly great, because you can find almost anything you want. Research is a piece of cake, you know, like within maybe an hour, you can get fantastic information on anybody, on any art stream, you name it, you know. The danger is, though, that when you click on things, you see a picture, or you see a face, or you hear something, then you might think that you know it, or you have heard it, or you have seen it before. And that's, I think, probably a big mistake. You know, it makes a difference if you travel to a different country, or if you meet a composer live, or you spend a week with an instrument maker, you see the whole process, and instead of just clicking on links, and you hop from one picture or subject to the other, you know. It's very addictive. It's also a habit. I can hardly stop when I get into things, and it's super exciting. But to learn people through that, or do you think, wow, I've seen it, I've experienced it, I've even to experience a certain culture? No, for sure. The conductor is a bit of a weird creature in front of a Baroque orchestra. Although I have to say, you know, like conducting always existed, even when you think about a group of singers performing Gregorian chant, I think it's very helpful when one of the singers takes the initiative and just give a pulse, or makes a move, or makes things clear. So in my role as conductor, I can say, well, that's not quite authentic. At the same time, I don't think too much about it, because also I don't want to have the overhead. So as conductor, I think you have to conduct a group. Not have to, but I think it's helpful when a group is larger than 20 people, you know? And that mostly has something to do with the space in between musicians. But honestly, I like rather to coordinate. I like to keep gestures rather small. I never like to stand on a stage. I don't want this typical conductor stand. And I also don't find it necessary to have a stick. And what I like to share with my musicians is I like to observe movements. I like to see every bow stroke. And I like to bring this in contact with the articulation of wind players, with the fingering of keyboardist. And that's my modest role. As an instructor, conductors should be inspiring and give a bit of a sense of what's so exciting about the music you play or which you share. If you give a great example, one image can sometimes cover more than 1,000 words, for sure. That's part of human fantasy, but hopefully it will trigger something in the mind of somebody else who might have a completely different, you know, idea to it. But at least then you can talk. The interesting question is, as a performer, this is very simple actually, but it has to do with an order of choice. So, in general, there is the music, often by somebody else. Number two, you deal with an instrument and yourself. And actually, it's up to you in what order you want to put it. Sometimes you have to change the order. I think when you always pick the same order, you get bored yourself, but then also an audience will get bored. You know? But perhaps it also has something to do with the message of the art form where you're dealing with. I'm sure sometimes it's good to even put yourself in front, and then maybe your instrument, and then the music. And very often I have also moments, like I'm not important at all. I just try to serve to my own thinking, of course. But I really try to get all the attention to the music. And sometimes it's even better to turn the lights off. Really. It's not important that you see somebody or you have the latest Gucci shoes on or whatever. It's just distracting, you know. Another thing which you'll never forget, I had a great colleague in Amsterdam, flute faculty, and he got hooked on the shakuhachi, and many people thought he lost it. I didn't think so, but suddenly he loved the shakuhachi, and then decided to go to Japan and film all great players. And this person was also teaching in Bremen, Germany. So they had the funds to invite one of his Japanese teachers. And I thought, okay, I have to do this well. So he was designing a poster for his master and, you know, dates and everything. And I thought, you know what, actually, just to make 100% sure, I'm going to send the design to my Japanese master to see if he agrees yes or no. So he did, answered him back, because he had the picture and everything, like name, huge poster. I said, no picture, no name, not important, he said, only instrument. which is great. You know, and I thought, yeah, it's actually great antidote is how sometimes people present themselves. You know, they blow themselves up to unknown proportions, and then you think, what's actually the message? You know, and so therefore I'm saying it's just, it depends on the order you have in mind. In addition, one of the most interesting things I learned from the past was reading a book about a dancing master. No, it was actually a student of a dance master in Italy, also 14th century. And it has to do with this question. So, and also order of events. This is all about dance, but certainly valid for any musician too. It's about the what musicians very often question is that, well, actually, do I play for the audience or do I play for myself? Something like that. This is certainly not answered in this booklet, but it says, okay, the first thing you have to do, very simple, find the right spot on stage. We laugh about it, okay? But honestly, look around, how people are standing, sitting. It's like looking at a bunch of Quasimodos, you know? The stand is covering 3/4 of their faces. We don't see one single action on a fingerboard or a change of bow, for example, when you deal with a string player. You know, we watch hips instead of that we see somebody like full in the face. Even this simple thing is forgotten, like in, 89% of all cases. No? Number two, in this little booklet, but I'll never forget it because I'm also trying to use it because I found it so beautiful. Memoria. I said, okay, as a dancer, you just have to make sure that you remember every single step. So you remember every single action you do, also in an instrument. Number three, elegancia. So you not only find the right spot, you remember everything well, but you do it also with great elegance. Number four, and that's the great thing, you use prontezza, as they call it in Italian. And that means just in American, you would say, be cool. So anything you do, you remember it well, you did it elegant, but it also should look like a piece of cake. You know where expression comes? Number 8 or 9. Because they said, these people said, if you do all these things right, you don't need so much anymore. And you can leave it up to the audience if they think that you play for them or vice versa. Not important. And I actually strongly believe in this recipe. I found it amazing. And I found it so clever that people really thought about this already. It's a long time ago. And it absolutely works, you know. Right now, in this upcoming program, we're doing in a smaller setting, by the way, but a lamento by the uncle of Johann Sebastian Bach, Johann Christoph. Just a setting of, which was a bit popular in northern Germany. They called it Abendmusiken, so evening music. A bit, you know, the pieces of Vespers, where you just have a small group of singers and you have a few string players, and you have maybe 2 cornetti or a few sackbuts, and just a mixture of that I've found really appealing. Just to make a sort of a choice of what we call masterpieces, I think it's first of all it's a very personal choice, but I feel very much attracted to the 17th century, but maybe it's also because I'm from Amsterdam. I don't know, maybe it's in my veins a little bit. But I really have to say, I love the paintings from this time. I love the still lifes. I like the symbolism behind the paintings. I like the attention for details, in which you also find in etchings. I'm very fond of etchings too. And there also, I can be just amazed to think, How, like, yeah, like with some tools, and you have a little hammer, and you can create such an incredible sky in the etching. Like, wow, you know. So I don't know the subtleties. I found the subtleties actually in the art of especially the 17th century. I'm very fond of, and also hear that in music. If you give me a time machine, I would certainly try it out, you know. But I think, yeah, imagine that it would be possible, and you get back, and then you try to explain people, and they think you're nuts. That's probably would be the answer. But at least you would have a great secret, or yeah. But anyway, I think we should never forget ourselves.